This is your victory. Victory of the cause of freedom.
This is Birmingham, Britain's second city, a giant Midland sprawl containing not just 1,001 trades, giants like the National Exhibition and National Convention Centres. And of course, 148 miles from the sea, the equally world-famous Nautical Club. It's the unique watering hole for seafarers from all branches of the Royal Navy. The port of call it is for all salty ones. And a happy little ship is this. Always a cheerful welcome aboard.
Arr, welcome aboard, John, my lad.
Well, here I am, surrounded by artifacts and naval history, and the club's members still full of the Nelson spirit.
Of spirits!
Captain, you're a founder member of this club, but why stick it in the heart of Birmingham?
Well, Birmingham, it was, and may be still, the largest recruiting area for the Navy in the country.
And what do you think of the club when you look around it today?
I think it's gone from good to better.
We are outside the museum, Maritime Museum. I would think we are the finest club museum in the country, certainly the only naval club.
A VE Day, the 50th celebration coming up on Sunday, and the parade. Of course, being chairman here, you'll be on parade.
I'm going to lead it.
You're leading the parade?
I am.
To remember we didn't just always fight alone, the flags of our allies are hoisted. As they go up, the seamen of the British Navy begin their big day, their medals polished, trousers pressed, all ship-shape and Bristol fashion. A rum crew this lot, bless them.
Of the British and Commonwealth armies, using the time-honored and hallowed words of all sea soldiers throughout the generations.
O eternal Lord God, grant thy blessing, we beseech thee, on soldiers of the Crown serving all around the globe. Bestow thy crown of righteousness upon all their efforts and endeavours, and may their laurels be those of gallantry and honour, loyalty and courage. Ask these in the name of him whose courage never failed, our Redeemer, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Well, they marched up and they marched back again. They stood, sang and prayed at the service, remembering their fallen shipmates. It was a very hot, sunny day, but not one of them wavered. A wonderful show of pride and respect, but of course, as expected. On board here in Birmingham's unlikeliest port for those who fought the war at sea is Alec Wright, the club secretary. He's the sailor who now keeps the ship on course. You've got some extraordinary members in this club, haven't you?
We've got, we've got the one that was on the first ship sunk in the war, the Courageous. He's in hospital at the moment, having a bypass. And there's myself, who's on the last destroyer sunk in the war.
How many members have you got now?
I would think in the region now something like 500.
They're all good shipmates?
Not all. They all come and pay the subs each year, but they don't come so often. They're all getting a bit long in the tooth now, and with the drink and drive laws to come out here, it's a bit of a journey. But we do get them, and we also get visitors from all over the country.
Now, you've got so much on your walls and in showcases. It's a bit like a museum, this.
Well, it is. It really is, because it's almost uninsurable.
What's the future, do you think, for the club? As you say, sailors all get old in the tooth eventually, don't they?
Well, I would think eventually we will have to go in a bit more public issue fashion, but I would always want it to be, in the years to come, still have all the memorabilia, everything in here, and perhaps then some of our grandsons and great-grandsons will come in and say, oh, yeah, my father, grandfather was on one of those.
One of your pictures is of a VC.
We've got the Savage VC corner in the top room.
Was he a Brummy?
He was a Brummy. He worked for Mitchells and Butlers. And the club, when his widow had to sell the his VC, the club raised over £10,000 towards. I think we were the biggest donator towards.
What did he do to get the VC?
He was on a gun on the bows of an MTB, sent us here landings, and I believe he had something like 28 bullet holes when he finally went. But he just stayed on the gun and fired and fired and fired.
Some gunner, wasn't he?
I'd like you to come and meet our chairman, Stan Skippins, Royal Marine, and he saw some considerable war service on several ships.
Shoot!
Mr. Chairman, you were a gunner with the Royal Marines, and you did the convoy run up to Russia and back many times. Yes. In winter.
Yes.
They must have been tremendous runs for you.
Well, the first one we did it early in 43. They told us we were getting the worst weather that for 80 years.
Did you cop it?
We did. And
what was it like?
Horrible.
Did you see any action at all?
Oh yes, we were in the Battle of the North Cape.
Yeah.
And we helped to sink the Sharnoffs.
What, the German pocket battleship?
That's right.
The big boy?
Yes, right.
And you were firing your gun, were you?
Yeah, 6-inch guns.
How long were you firing at him for?
Well, we had two goes at him when we chased him off into sea, and then when in the evening when we finished him in about 9 o'clock.
How many times do you reckon you hit him?
Well, they told us we hit him with one of our tubes, and we had about six on the ship, because we couldn't see anything.
There were about 1,500 German seamen on that ship.
Yeah.
How many survived?
Only 33.
Is that all?
That's all.
Well, wonderful war medals, but what on earth this Jim will fix it medal for?
A friend of mine wrote up to Jim will fix it about 8 years ago and asked would he take us, a husband and his friend Jack Marsh, over to Normandy beaches, landed on the same beach as we did during the war.
Yeah. Now, Jack Marsh, you were a
Royal Naval Commando.
A commando?
Royal Naval Commando, not Royal Marine. They get us mixed up.
Right, you're still a tough bunch, my gun, weren't you?
Yeah, we're still going.
Now, on D-Day itself, when you landed there...
I landed.
You got off the boat nice and cleanly, didn't you?
Yeah.
Right, and ran up the beach.
And we was in Lee Hamel then. We went to German headquarters. We landed there. We rode on Lee Hamel, the stronghold of the German headquarters.
Yeah. Now, when Jim will fix it took you there,
he took
you didn't quite get off the boat as cleanly as you did on the real D-Day, did you?
No, I went in the Oggin.
You fell in the water?
Yeah, up to here.
What are you doing that for?
Stayed down the ramp, the Lincoln Royal Marines, he dropped us and there's a bar across there, and he's deep the other side, the
you
bar.
You could have drowned, Jack.
Oh, no.
Had you had a few tots on the way over?
I did the night before, Calvados.
Could have helped.
Calvados. Yeah.
Well done, sailor.
Yeah.
At the moment, we can see two bright flashes, three flashes from the other side of the channel, and three great puffs of smoke, another fourth. And any moment now, the shells will be arriving over this side. Four columns of smoke going up on the far side, as the convoy goes past us here. And there's the explosion. And the second. Just a very short way in front of us, the sea here. Tremendous column of water goes up. There's a third bomb just come down now. And there's one more to come, and there it is.
Now, Kathleen Cunningham, you were a wartime rent.
Yes, I was.
Where were you stationed?
Well, mostly Gosport in the Portsmouth area.
And what were you doing down there?
Well, I was a chief wren writer, which means that we were the clerical branch of the Navy and dealt with all correspondence.
So you were a secretary to who?
Well, I was on the captain's staff. The captain would have a staff of perhaps 40 or 50, and I would just be a member on his staff.
It was a big staff, wasn't it?
Oh, it was.
Which
one
was it then?
Well, it was Coastal Forces.
Oh, my word.
Which are the motor torpedo boats and the motor launches of the Navy, the little ships.
Well, now you're a landlubber, and you're based now not near the sea, but in the Midlands, in the heart of Birmingham.
Yes.
What's the club mean to you?
Oh, a great deal. It's a wonderful club with wonderful companionship. It's a first-class club.
Well, how do you get on with the old sea dogs?
Fine. I'm a old sea dog, so we all get on very well.
You're a right bunch, eh?
Cut that out.
Have you had your little trot of rum?
Only sippers. I don't like spirits very much.
Who'd you give it to, then?
Well, people sitting round. We all had a little drop.
Sid Denham, you were in the submarine service for 20 years, unbelievably, and got away with it.
Yes.
Five boats, five different submarines.
Yes.
All sorts of action.
Yeah.
You've got a row of gongs here. Extraordinary, really. I think you must have a record. I can't think of any book that's got a serving submariner that's done 20 years or more.
And still able to walk.
What was it like, Sid?
I thought it was great. Although I had to go down onto the bilges at different times to sort out where the leak was and the slush and all that underneath. And they bloody near drowned me one day. And I come out because I asked them in the control room to keep the bow down a little bit, so that I'd be clear of the water, bilge was oil and that. And of course some silly bugger had to do it in the control room. And I was underneath the pipe and I was stuck there and it come all over my bloody face, black oil. And you can imagine when I got out, I went into the control room and I was very rude to some of them. And
did you feel quite safe in them?
Oh, yes. Well, I mean, when they're banging, like, you know, up top, it's a bit frightening.
Depth charged?
Yeah. But
how many times were you depth charged?
Oh, dozens and dozens of times. All over the world as well.
How frightening is that, Sue?
It is. I refuse to be frightened. But you could see all the other kids, and they are looking at me as well.
Yeah.
If I'm looking at going to be frightened, they're going to be in a worse state. So I just didn't be. I used to tell them when the Royal Baton come down, saying that if that was another half a mile closer, we'd have had it. This just dropped out. Yeah. Right.
Paulton, you were in the Merchant Navy sailing regularly to South America and back on what they called the meat run, helping to feed us at home and the army. What was your most vivid experience of all that?
I suppose really my first trip down to South America, which was Rio de Janeiro, Montevideo and Buenos Aires, and I saw the remains of the Graff Strait in Montevideo Harbour. And I saw the remains of that. It was quite something, that, to look at that the wreck of that there. It was really, really something.
Well, as you sailed into Montevideo Harbour, it must have been an uplifting experience to see the floundering hulk of the Graf Spee, of all ships, and then to find out it had been chased there by the Achilles, the Ajax, and the Exeter.
Absolutely. Because I'll tell you what, the Grabs Bay really was... We used our lifeline for the food coming back to Britain in those days. Beef and all that stuff from the Argentine. We depended so much to get down there and get back. But the Grabs Bay was actually blowing them out of the water, or left, right and centre. But when the battle took place, Ajax Achilles exited up and trapped it into Montevideo Harbour. It was wonderful to see that we'd finished it up. Lovely. Wonderful.
But when you were in Montevideo, did you hear anything about Captain Langsdorff, the commander of the Grabs Bay?
Captain Langsdorff was a perfect gentleman. One of the very, very few.
Of the old school?
He was a perfect gentleman. He actually made all his crew, his sailors and officers go ashore, and they all went to Buenos Aires, and he committed suicide. But he was a gentleman.
Frank Crockett, you were a Royal Marine.
Yep.
HMS Birmingham.
Yep.
1943, off Alexandria. What happened?
Yeah, well, we took a convoy through from Greenock. We left the convoy at Gibraltar, and we're sailing through the Mediterranean on our own. On Sunday morning, November the 28th, there was a terrific explosion. We'd been torpedoed.
What were you doing at the time, Frank?
Well, at the time, I was polishing my cap badge and cleaning my hat, ready to go ashore at Alexandria. But we didn't get that far that night.
When the torpedo hit you,
yeah.
What's it feel like on board?
Well, the ship went up in the air, it leaped up in the air, and it came down, up again, and then she settled in the water.
It was a bow hit, was it?
It hit us right in the bows, yeah.
It's a wonder she didn't go down.
It is a wonder, there's no doubt about it. Of course, you've got your watertight compartments that you all shut with the damage control, and that's what kept the ship afloat.
Did you ever find out how many torpedoes the U-boat fired?
Yes, we were told officially that there was 3 fired, 2 went forward of us, and the 3rd one got us.
That was a miracle, wasn't it?
Well, it was a miracle, yeah.
So what happened then? I mean, you couldn't sail, really, could you?
Oh, well, of course, we did stop. 2 destroyers came over the horizon. I've never been so pleased to see destroyers in my life. Put hawsers round us and kept the bows up, and that way we got to Alexandria.
And then what happened there?
We went into dry dock. In dry dock, they fixed steel plates all the way around the hole. And then they poured in concrete. In the space, they poured in loads and loads of concrete. This was to save the plates buckling in again.
Good heavens.
And it was also to give us ballast so that our next stage would have to be over America to get repaired.
Good heavens. So you sailed to America with a concrete ship?
With a concrete bows.
Good Lord. The only one in the Royal Navy ever to do that, I
Well, I should imagine so. I don't know of another anyway.
Well, during the war years, there were many unsung heroes, amongst them some of the members from this club. Amongst them, too, was a man who in 1943 was drawn into one of the most audacious plots ever devised to completely fool 100% the German High Command.
At night, sir? Anybody in his senses knows we shall go through Sicily anyway.
So we got everything to gain and nothing to lose. Let the plan be implemented.
Thank you, sir. All right, Montague, you've got the all clear.
And your submarine's fixed. Jewell is sailing in Seraph for Malta on Friday.
Jewell? He's the man who put Mark Clark ashore in Africa and rescued General Giro, so you're in good hands. Can you make it?
I assure you, sir, we shall make it.
Good. Carry on.
Submarine captain extraordinaire, Captain Norman Jewell, how did you get involved in the extraordinary plot to fool the Germans? A plot we all know now as the man who never was.
Well, I was refitting in Blythe, having a new bow put onto the submarine. I was sent for to London to, first of all, to go to flag off the submarines, where I was introduced to the man who had thought out this problem. And quite honestly, at the minute, I can't even remember his name, which is terrible, isn't it?
In a nutshell, for those that probably don't know, what was the problem? What were you trying to achieve?
What we were trying to achieve was to show that a courier going to North Africa was to tell General Eisenhower that their plan for attacking Sicily was going to be put off and we were going to attack Greece instead. And as a courier had been lost from an aircraft shortly before this, I was called down to London, they thought this was a good opportunity to put another courier in the water with all the right papers on him and with letters to General Eisenhower and Admiral Mountbatten, from Admiral Mountbatten, and saying just this, that the plan of attack had been changed and they were going to Greece instead.
So we put him on board the Seraph, did they?
Suitable body was found in London, and he was completely prepared for looking as though he had drowned. And then, when my refit was completed and we were on the way back to the Mediterranean, the body was brought to the depot ship and dropped into us through the torpedo hatch and stayed in the place of one of the torpedoes throughout our voyage to the south of Portugal, where Portugal joins Spain.
And you had to give the order, put him into the torpedo tube, did you?
No, we didn't put him into a torpedo tube. He was already in a thing that looked like a small torpedo, but was in fact filled with dry ice inside with the body and very well insulated on the outside, so the body would remain intact. So it had just recently died. So when he was put out into the water, he would look the real thing.
I always thought he was fired from the torpedo.
No, he wasn't there. We had to unscrew the tube, get him out, and we said a prayer over him as we put him gently over the side.
And what was the outcome of all this?
Well, the Germans picked him up and they went very carefully over him and decided it was a true story. And as a result, a lot of the armour, which was in Sicily, was removed, so that when the time to land our troops there came, there was very little armour in the island.
What are you up to these days?
Me? I'm a very retired officer.
You still haven't written your book,
enjoying,
have you?
No, and will not.
Why is that?
Well, I think that so many other people have written books about everything I've done, but I think it's better left to them.
But you've done quite a bit more than a lot of people did.
No, I don't think that's really true. I've done what I was asked to do, and that's all really that matters, I think.
I've asked several sailors, seamen, what their medals stand for. Amongst your splendid lot, what have you got?
Well, we have a MBE for, I can't even remember now, I think that's for taking General Giraud or something out of France. A DSC, which came for, you know, proper operations in the Mediterranean. And then at the back end, we've got an American Legion of Merit. And this is obviously for taking Mark Clark and also for taking or being the marker submarine for the Americans landing in Sicily. And then there's from General Giraud, we have a Legion d'honneur and then a Croix de Guerre with palm. But
tremendous stuff. Have a good dinner, Captain.
Well, I hope so.
Well, it's no wonder this club is known throughout the world. Everywhere you look, badges, pictures, oil paintings, artifacts, everything here. Brilliant stuff, all donated by servicemen, past and present, stationed throughout the world. Come and have a look. As usual, there's something cooking in the galley, grubbed to gladden the cockles of the seamen's hearts, and their ladies too. As ever, Captain Norman Jewell, chairman of the Submariners Old Comrades Association, who originally set up the Nautical Club. A quiet-mannered man who, like the rest, ran silent and very deep. What a bunch they are, Submariners unique. Men who had the training, the nerve, and the incredible knack not to suffer, well, not too much anyway, claustrophobia. Yes, these are the lads who fought and lived in His Majesty's tin fish. They've surfaced again, so far from the sea, to take another crack dive. But this time, their noses aren't heading towards David Jones's locker, but to their dinner plates. The steak, the like they never saw in war, and of course, there has to be a fish on the plate. The finest poached Scotch salmon. Neptune looked kindly on this bunch, and for those ashore who couldn't possibly think about diving in a submarine, let alone in wartime, are more than proud of them, every one of them, who couldn't be here this evening. Bless them all. In a corner of this club, which lies as steady as a ship in dry dock, sit another group of pals, the lads who kept the propellers turning, the engine room boys.
Well, here we are. We've got some engine room ratings with us. Sweat rags, that's what they called you. Why do they call you sweat rags?
Work that bloody
No, because when we were watchkeeping down below, it got very, very hot, and we always used to have sweat rags around our necks or tucked in your belt so you could mop your brow and, you know, mop the sweat off.
Well, how hot was it down there in the engine room?
Anything from 100 to 130 degrees in the boiler room, if you're up the Persian Gulf or down by Aden or anywhere.
Good Lord. When you went into action, what happened to you? You're below.
Button down.
All watertight doors are
closed, you're
battened
down.
Actually, you're
battened
down.
So you can't get out?
No.
But when you went into battle, you didn't know what was happening at all upstairs, did you?
Not really, no.
So you never saw anything?
No, you just heard it.
You heard it all right. Anybody had kamikaze after you?
We had a kamikaze.
We had a kamikaze.
What happened then?
Well, it blew the centre barrier out and all through the island, and the sick bay was in the island, blew that out as well.
You weren't battened down underneath?
No, I was up on the arrest on the flight deck.
And you saw the Japanese plane coming in?
I said it come in, go up, and then come down again.
And what did you do?
Well, I would get down.
Job anyhow.
When I was a first class stoker, I was on the destroyer, and down below in the boiler room, action stations went, and they all went to action stations. We were there. And the PO in charge down there, I see him move away because he had the most comfortable chair, you see, under a fan blowing all the nice hot air down, a cold air down on him. And I noticed Stoker PO, he gets up and he walks away and he goes to the foot of the ladder. Also, he's just stretching his legs. All of a sudden, Stoker PO was another step up the ladder. Time went on, you know, all back to normal. P.O. come up to me, he says, "Hey, Brum," I was only about 18 and a half at the time. He says, "Hey, Brum," he says, "you're a bloody cool customer." I said, "Well, you say that to P.O.?" He said, "You're on the baller front there," he says, taking no notice, just carrying on. He said, "And the tin fish are going underneath," he says, "but you didn't turn a hair." I didn't even know what they were. I'd never heard of before.
You might have beat him to the top of the ladder.
I'd never heard this torpedo go underneath before.
What did you think about the other lads on board that weren't in the engine room?
Not a lot.
Not a lot.
Not the dab-dabs.
Well, there's a saying, all fuel and salt water never mix, you know. That's a seaman in the engine room. Right?
They were passengers.
We used to get on with the Royal Marines.
Royal Marines, yeah.
We used to get on with them because they used to shove them next to us. Then.
Always were like...
You were just like an exclusive little club room.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Every mess.
And you still are, aren't you? In this club.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
You don't mix that much, do you? You stick together still.
That's right.
50 years on, I mean.
Yeah.
I think you find that rather remarkable.
No, in particular.
Well, with their girls who still love a sailor, the stokers are getting up steam again for a 1940s knees up. They're in the mood, all right.